Lectures and Exhibitions Committee. And before I introduce Mr. Bernier this evening, I wonder if I could just remind you to silence your cell phones. You haven't done so already. I think everyone has. It's with the greatest of pleasure that I'm welcoming distinguished historian Olivier Bernier, an expert in the field of decorative arts. Mr. Bernier has spent the greater part of a lifetime lecturing and publishing upon not just the fine and decorative arts, but architecture and cultural history. His sold-out lecture series at the Metropolitan Museum will be familiar to many of you. We were thrilled when Mr. Bernier agreed to examine the books and papers and letters, statues and paintings that were bequeathed to us as a legacy from Sarah Parker Goodhue, one of our most generous benefactors. If you look around the room, you'll notice the china on the wall is from Mrs. Goodhue, as are the portraits behind me, and those you will have passed on your way up the staircase this evening. Mr. Bernier's essay on the collection is the centerpiece of our catalog. Sarah Parker Goodhue, A Hidden Collection Comes to Light, and I do want you to notice how this beautifully photographed cover could double as a Victoria's Secret catalog and a prize for anyone who can identify where this detail occurs. Mr. Bernier's essay and his talk tonight put the Goodhue Collection in the context of American interior design and taste. I hope that those of you who have not seen it yet in the Peluso Family Exhibition Gallery just outside this room will take the time to do so after his talk. Mr. Bernier, a graduate of Harvard and the Institute of Fine Arts at New York University, has written many books on art, culture, and on European history, and he's contributed a great many articles to the New York Times, to Antiques Magazine, and many other publications. As a treat, I would suggest that after you read his essay in our catalog, you take a peek at his articles in the New York Times on traveling in India and in Italy. My particular favorite is an article he wrote a number of years ago on visiting the golden city of Jaisalmer in Rajasthan. In 2006, Mr. Bernier received the award of the Chevalier of Arts and Letters from the French government. He's currently at work on a new book, and after Christmas, he will be taking a group for the Metropolitan Museum to Cambodia and Vietnam. I feel somehow I've just scratched the surface of his accomplishments. Finally, I'd like to say a word to you about the annual fund. I'm happy to report that the city's oldest library is going strong after 261 years. And the only reason this is possible is because of the generosity of members who've chosen to support the library above and beyond our membership fees. Please give as generously as possible to the annual fund so the library can continue to build the collection, to maintain the expanded hours in this beautiful building, and also to support the events and lectures and the exhibitions, and especially the lecture you'll be hearing tonight. Now I'd like you to join me in welcoming Olivier Bernier.
When, roughly 100 years ago, Mrs. Goodhue decided to write a will leaving the bulk of her estate to the New York Society Library, she was doing so, of course, for a number of very good reasons. Her immediate descendants had not survived her, and also she was eager to preserve clearly her own memory, the memory of her husband's name, and just as important, perhaps, these collections which had been drawn together by her husband's family and by her own. Not least, it seems reasonably evident, because she thought those collections were both wonderful and unique. Well, in many ways she was right. The New York Society Library has preserved her collections and has preserved her name. Indeed, every time we walk into the library, there it is on the wall to our left, and because far from being unique or unusual, both these quite different collections, the collection of her husband's family and the collection of mostly her parents and her own collection, tell us a very great deal about the United States for well over 100 years, and in a period when the United States itself was in the middle of immense changes, was becoming quite a different country from the country it had begun to be in the 18th century. And it's because those collections reflect so closely what else was going on, it is precisely therefore because they're not unique that they tell us so much about the US. And as an added bonus, I may say, they tell us a good deal about both families and indeed about the majestic Mrs. Goodhue herself. She had a much younger friend, Mrs. Goodhue, whom she would invite to her country house and who has left unpublished memoirs. Having read, thanks to the wonderful staff work which enabled me to write that essay, having read the chapter written by that young man, which describes a dinner at Mrs. Goodhue, complete with many courses, many wonderful dishes, many servants, and standards so august that they would turn any of us into jelly in a second, I have come to the conclusion that it is simply not possible for me to say Sarah Goodhue. I can imagine the look I would be given if I said that. I always now call her Mrs. Goodhue, and if you have any doubt at all about that, just go look at her portrait over there. Well, in fact, it seemed only right to begin with Mrs. Goodhue. Still, as you can see, a fairly young woman, already a very majestic woman, who was entirely clear about what in her collection would be appropriate. And there's only one word for that, royal. As we will see in a moment, her parents first, and then she herself proceeded to buy objects which are, in some cases rightly, in another case not quite rightly, but which both were convinced had come directly from the French royal family. And it's amusing, I think, to see that in what is after all a republic, then already, but only then, and of course today still, royalty appears to have an endless fascination. Well, Mr. Goodhue's family began early, did well early. Already at the time of the Revolution, the Goodhues were very prosperous merchants from Massachusetts, and indeed merchants with, it became very rapidly evident, a remarkably good eye for painting. Now, the fledgling United States were, as you know, in many ways, a primitive country. It was a not yet industrial country. Nails had to come from Great Britain, so did darning needles, etc. It was a country that, as we all know, came together from quite different parts. Obviously, there was not much in common between, say, Maine and South Carolina, and a country which had yet to distinguish itself for its artistic achievement. It is a characteristic of all galleries in which we see early American paintings that while they may have a certain naive appeal, clearly technique is what leaves a little bit to be desired. And the remarkable thing about the Goodhue family is that from the 18th century on, they managed to find painters who were not only technically, but I think generally, better than the run of painters who could be hired at that particular moment. The normal formula in the 1770s, 1780s was very simple. The painter arrived with his prepared canvas. So if it was a lady's portrait, the dress and the hands and the little bouquet of flowers would already be painted, and then the painter would come take a good look at the lady's face and do the best he could with it. Or if it was a gentleman, there would be the gentleman's clothing, preferably something the which told us what an important gentleman he was, all ready done, and then once again the face would be painted. So you can see that pretty well everywhere. If you go to the American galleries at the Met, the painting galleries, you'll see with the very early paintings that same mask-like quality of the faces in these works. And if you look at the painting on the left, although it is already a good deal better, that particular artist managed to do very nicely with white satin, as you can see, and the face is very far from the standard frozen smile that you normally expect. In fact, there is a look of enormous self-satisfaction on that particular face. I personally find it quite irresistible. This is a lady who knew exactly what she wanted, got it, and wants to make sure we know she got it. But it is already very much livelier than one might have expected. And when we get to the portrait of an early Mrs. Goodhue, a portrait of the 1780s, which we see here on the right, what we see is in fact a very good portrait in which we discover something which remained true for several generations. The Mrs. Goodhues, very evidently, tended to be highly intelligent women. There could be no mistaking the liveliness of the eyes, the mixture of interest and very slight censoriousness in the face, which we see here on the right. This is quite clearly a woman, perhaps not quite at the level of Mrs. Adams, but one of these women who, at the end of the 18th century, startled visitors to America, most notably French visitors to America, because they were so smart and so independent, and distressed the French visitors to America very greatly, because they were both good-looking and virtuous. The good-looking part didn't distress the French visitors at all. The virtuous part did. They found it incomprehensible and altogether deplorable. And I dare say that if any French visitor to Massachusetts, and there were quite a number of the French in Massachusetts during the War of Independence, I suspect that if any of those French had suggested a tryst to Mrs. Goodhue here on the right, things would not have gone well for him. Indeed, as we keep looking at a succession of Mrs. Goodhues, what we see is a number of very individual women, like the one you see here, and women who show us more and more clearly that the Goodhues are getting to be not just prosperous, but really quite seriously rich. What we see here, of course, is a very expensive dress with that highly fashionable collar. You see the many-layered collar right there, but also notice this Indian shawl, this Kashmiri shawl. You see a little bit more of it over there. They were extremely expensive Kashmiri shawls. The one we're looking at here, which is clearly the real thing, as opposed to English copies made in Paisley, well, I should say Scottish copies made in Paisley. She probably, or her husband, paid the equivalent in our money of something like $15,000 to $20,000 for that shawl. And it is not by accident, therefore, that we see it in this painting. And again, a very obviously intelligent woman whom we see here. And it's really quite fascinating because we're now being told a number of new things. Not only that this is a clearly thoughtful and intelligent woman, but also that she thinks her position is a very important one. Because if you look at this ermine-like arrangement you see right here, well, I remind you that an ermine lining was what you saw on the cloaks of kings, queens, and great aristocrats. So, to show us in a portrait this very evident border of ermine is telling us a good deal about what an important woman we are looking at. Then, of course, she's extremely fashionably dressed, and most of all, perhaps, she is wearing an extremely impressive tiara. Now, can we tell whether those are, in fact, large emeralds with small rubies? You see the emeralds up here and the rubies just below. Well, not really, perhaps. are peridots and garnets. But we'll hope, for the sake of the Goodhues and of this Mrs. Goodhue's, that they were the real thing and quite expensive gems. And so what we, and by now we are in the late 1820s, what we see in these few years from roughly 1780 to perhaps 1825, what we see during this more or less half century is the continuous rise of a family in the eastern United States. The Goodhues eventually moved from Massachusetts to New York, where they stayed until the death of our Mrs. Goodhue's husband, the last of the Goodhues, and a family which managed to prosper as the country prospered, and was also, from the beginning, very much involved in its great adventure of the 1770s and 1780s. What you're looking at here is another, I think, quite good portrait of Senator Goodhue, Jonathan Goodhue. Now, surely none of you can doubt that he was an important man, not only because of his expression, but because of the vast expanse carefully revealed of his waistcoat. And I remind you that, contrarily to what the case is these days, it was a very good thing to be quite large at the end of the 18th century for men, particularly because it was a sign of success, of course. And so Senator Goodhue, looking appropriately serious, is obviously a man, he was a senator from Massachusetts, is obviously a man whom you had to respect and whose words were worth listening to. And we will see in a moment that in fact he corresponded with people with whom you're familiar, George Washington, John Adams. You really can't do much better than that. Not only that, George Washington, as you know, was a very great man in just about every possible way, but he was also an eminently practical man. He was clear about the fact that money was not to be wasted, and very careful about listing his expenses when he was at the head of the Continental Army, and not at all averse to receiving gifts in kind, providing that nothing was expected from him. This is not at all the same idea as a PAC giving money to a political candidate and expecting that the political candidate will toe the line. And so we know, because of the correspondence, that in fact Senator Goodhue on occasion sent fresh fish from Massachusetts to the by then retired President Washington, who was extremely pleased to get the fish. So, as you can see, a really important man, but again, an important man who found a painter capable of showing him not as a standard portrait of a successful person, but as the person he really was. Now, I have to tell you, this is a terrible image, so please look at him there on the right. It's much better than the image on the screen. And what you see there, and we're now in the late 1830s, early 1840s, is another aspect of the Goodhue men, which is by then a kind of refinement and intelligence, which should not surprise us, because when you look at the books which Mrs. Goodhue left the library, you find that in fact that particular Mr. Goodhue was reading the first editions of Dickens, was keeping up with the new books of his period, obviously a man who, since they all did, clearly made a good deal of money, but at the same time had very real cultural interests. And here is the last of the male Goodhues we will allow him to look at. No portraits that we have at any rate after this, but you can see that as the generations pass, we go from Senator Goodhue, who was clearly a force of nature, to Goodhue men who are increasingly refined and thoughtful. This is very much what we see in this portrait. And that transition from the perhaps slightly more elemental beginnings to the much more sophisticated and refined later period, that is very much what was happening, generally speaking, certainly in the northeastern United States. Now, once again, all you have to do sitting in this room is turn your head in that direction, and you will see exactly what you're seeing on the screen. A number of the plates, etc., that were collected by the Goodhues and which were part of the collection, therefore, when it came to the library. And it's really interesting because these plates, we'll look at some of them in detail in a second, are of two, from the beginning, quite different kinds. There are the Staffordshire or proto-Staffordshire plates, the ones you see here, we'll look at them in a second, which, after all, are extremely decorative. I personally am very fond of them, but let's face it, there is a difference between Staffordshire and porcelain, and the early Goodhues, as far as we can tell at least, were not buying porcelain. They were, in other words, too shrewd to spend a very great deal of money, as porcelain imported to the United States would have been, too shrewd to spend a very great deal of money on things which were not absolutely essential. So you have Staffordshire, and then you have, you see on the top shelf there, you have what are obviously, cheaper copies, imitations of Asian porcelain, but not the real thing, which again would have been too expensive. And then they bought really very simple objects. And I must tell you that when I first came to look at the collection a little while ago now, I was very taken in particular by this picture. You can see that on this side there is an impressive looking ship. Well, Senator Goodhue was a great trader. The fortune he made from the goods which his ships brought back to the United States. And I must say, I think it's really rather touching that we should have what is obviously a very plain piece of Fayence, but a charming one, as part of the collection. And, of course, on the other side of that picture, there is an, to my mind, charming and irresistible verse. It says, "My lad is far upon the sea. His absence makes me..." Okay, it's hard to read from here. Thank you. "The bark that bears him far from me, I hope, will safe return. And from his earnings, I'll save up, if lucky he should be. And then, when old, with me shall stay and go no more to sea." Well, it was no joke being a sailor in the 18th century. Our ships foundered all too frequently. Sailors were swept overboard by storms. The physical conditions in which they lived were simply appalling. And I must say, I find this picture really quite touching because that is about the life of a significant portion of the male population of the northeastern coast of the US. And then there's another little verse which I again found, I must say, completely irresistible. "My love is fixed, I cannot change. I like my choice too well to change." I thought that was a wonderful way to say, "I'm not going to bother finding anyone else. I've got him, I'll keep him." And I also think it's rather, not just interesting, really rather touching, that the very prosperous Goodhues were willing to buy these very, very simple pieces of faience. The plates that they bought also tell us a very great deal about the United States. This particular plate, it's somewhere on those shelves. This particular plate, which at the top says "Peace on Earth," shows us, and at the bottom, "Give us this day our daily bread," shows us a sort of perfectly peaceful land in which, as you can see, the lion, who has clearly just gone to a really good hairdresser and been given some impressive hair extensions. A lion together with a cow, always a symbol of prosperity, and a deer, etc., etc., more animals here. We are shown these new United States with, you see, the radiant light over there. The United States is far away from Europe and from its troubles, and indeed, in one of his letters to Senator Goodhue, Washington said that he thought that the United States should stay well away from the wars and other complications of Europe. And so what we have is a sort of naive, of course, but charming representation of what it meant to be in these new United States, how it felt to be a newly independent American. And then, in plate after plate, we have views of various sites in the Northeast, including a sort of seriously rearranged capital. And I have to tell you that this, when this plate was made, the capital was not yet built. But it's all very appealing. You see, we're shown this new country in which already the buildings which shelter this new republican form of government exist, even if it's only a fantasy, and in which we're told, again, the point of the United States is that it is peaceful and prosperous through agriculture. And you can see those cows sitting there looking as happy as cows can look, are clearly meant to tell us that this is, it's very Jeffersonian view, I suppose you could say, of the United States. But we need to imagine Senator Goodhue and his family having their meals on these plates, looking at them with great satisfaction, and also being thrilled by what they must have heard about the more western part of the eastern United States. These mountains, which no one had yet quite conquered, these little houses by probably a river, and as you can see also here, the happy couple, in, I'm happy to say, the latest fashion, walking past this appropriately modest, but therefore properly Republican house. You will notice that the two things no longer go together. And then, of course, there was that fascinating addition to the United States, the Indian population. And while things changed fairly rapidly, starting in the 1820s, at the end of the 18th century, it was still possible to envisage a country in which, essentially, people of English, Scottish, and Irish origin would live peacefully next to the tribes that had preceded their arrival there. And so this is really very much what you see here, and it's really, this plate was clearly made in England, because if you look at the architecture over there, it is sort of Chinesey. And clearly, whoever designed that plate said to himself, oh well, who knows what it's like on the other side of the world? Probably it's like China, so I'll put in a few Chinese buildings. And so there they are. But you see, there we have our two new Americans, so to speak, conversing amiably with an older, settled American. And just in case it occurred to you that neither New York nor Boston do palm trees really prosper very easily, whoever designed this plate in England cheerfully added, as you can see, palm trees right here, because, well, anyway, exotic should have palm trees, and so we get palm trees. And then, of course, there are objects, this is a sugar pot, which refer very specifically to the New Republic. You can see the eagle, the emblem of the United States, and the same is true of this coffee pot right here. It's almost exactly the still, the emblem of the United States, the one you still see on official buildings and on Air Force One. So what all of this shows us is the degree to which the events which created this country were an integral part of the people who lived here. And since I've mentioned letters from George Washington, I thought the least I could do was to show you this letter, as you can see, addressed to Benjamin Goodhue, Esquire. And this was a period when, I mean, these days, the only people you call Esquire are attorneys. But in the 18th century, Esquire meant, was more widespread. Not all attorneys in the 18th century were Esquires. All well-to-do men were. So the fact that Benjamin Goodhue is Esquire, in George Washington's able estimation, and furthermore benefits, as you can see, from Washington's great esteem and regard. And of course, it's that wonderful 18th century servant, I am, dear sir, your most obedient servant. But this is one of several letters which still happily exist here. And I also think it's rather amusing to see the difference between George Washington's small but very legible handwriting. And I can tell you, as a person who's read a lot of 18th century handwriting, George Washington is amazingly legible, but even more legible and even more orderly is John Adams. I mean, this is so easy to read even today, quite astounding. And so there are two possibilities. One, a secretary wrote it. Well, I suppose it's possible for John Adams' letter, although I don't think it's the case of this letter, not for George Washington's. He wrote his own, and especially since the little piece of letter I showed you was written after he had retired to Mount Vernon. And it really is quite wonderful, I think, that all of this has survived and is right here in this building where we are. Well, time passed, and I have to tell you, in all fairness, that fashions which had come and already gone in Europe tended to reach the United States fairly late. And that was the case of the fashion for profiles in shadow, which is what you see here. And so in the 1820s and 30s, quite a number of these were made, really handsome, and often, however, not terribly informative. On occasion, and I suspect perhaps not altogether intentionally, they were very informative. I am going to guess, feel free to disagree, that this is not a happy couple. There he is, sitting with his arms crossed and looking quite grim at a safe distance. This is Mr. Jonathan Gray. At a safe distance from the very sharp profile of Mrs. Gray, who is holding her fan very much the way you would hold a spear if you were going to war. And she's turning her back, furthermore, very firmly on her husband. So I must say, when I first saw this here, I said to myself, I'm really very glad they never asked me for dinner. Well, by the 1840s, when the Goodhues had moved to New York, New York had already begun to be, in some ways, what it is today. A city where there were quite a number of people with a great deal of money and people who liked other people to know that they had a great deal of money. And so there is this wonderful publication, Wealth and Biography of the Wealthy Citizens of New York City. And it enables us to know just how much money Mr. Goodhue had, a great deal less than John Jacob Astor, but still quite enough. And I think it's fascinating to see that this interest in, who has it and who hasn't, so to speak, was already well at the fore in, as you can see, 1845. Now, I mentioned to you that Mr. Goodhue of this period bought books, all kinds of interesting books. And, after all, he was still in shipping. So he bought quite good books, like, as you can see, A Sentimental Journey, a book which was published again, Stearns, of course, a book that was published again and again and again and again. But he also bought books that had perhaps a more immediate relevance to his business. In fact, he seems to be quite interested in Arctic explorations because there's this one here, and then, having survived in the collection, another one. You can see it's a different author. And this particular book, published in the 1850s, is handsomely illustrated, in particular, with what has happened, as you can see, to that ship caught in the ice somewhere in the Arctic. Really quite a spectacular, rather Gustave Doré-like engraving. And, of course, there is a book about pirates. After all, if you're in shipping, pirates are not a good thing. And although I'm not trying to remind you that, the end of October is not so far from us, I couldn't resist showing you this pirate who had finally been caught, and as you can see, hanged. But if you think this is Halloween-like, just wait till you see the next one. Pluming its head on the end of the bowsprit. I thought that was also pretty much irresistible. Now, the Goodhues had, as we've seen from these earlier portraits, they have been a, as far as we can tell, quite healthy family. And in the 1850s, things change. And this Mrs. Goodhue, really a very pretty early Victorian portrait, you see with her ringlets and her lacy veil and her big blue eyes, looks really rather fragile, and she was. She died quite young. And as I mentioned in the catalogue essay, she reminds me irresistibly of those Dickens heroines who die young, usually while coughing heavily. But it's a charming little portrait, and again, a tribute to the Goodhues for not buying the conventional, not commissioning the conventional from an artist. Now, it's time, I think, having had a good look at the Goodhues, it's time we went on to our Mrs. Goodhue's family, the Parkers, who were very well-to-do New Yorkers, and who did what was just becoming fashionable in the 1840s. They went to Europe every now and again. But not to understand, simply to take an extraordinarily uncomfortable boat, which in the 1840s still took at least 2 weeks to cross the Atlantic. No. The idea was to go to the courts of Europe and be presented at court. This seemed to have an irresistible attraction for them. And so Mr. and Mrs. Parker and their little daughter went to France in 1846 and were duly presented at the court of King Louis Philippe. And they traveled on, eventually came back to the United States, and then about a year and a half later, there was a revolution in France and King Louis Philippe was gone. Well, they came back, the Parkers, in 1850 and attended the auctions at which the furnishings from the Palace of the Tuileries and various other royal houses were being sold. And they bought, amongst other things, the curtains that Louis Philippe, the king, had in his bedroom at the Tuileries Palace. The curtains haven't survived, sadly, but the tiebacks of the curtains have, at least the one that you see over here. So, and King Louis Philippe was a very uxorious man, very happily married. He and his wife, Queen Marie Amélie, had a great number of children. On the relatively rare instances when they were separated, they wrote each other at least once a day, but often two or three times a day. And so we may imagine either Louis Philippe or Marie Amélie using the tie back that you see here to make the room darker or lighter. And at the end of the tie back, there is this little bronze plaque, which personally I found quite amusing, because in his youth, King Louis Philippe was a, how can I put it, theoretical general. I'll explain this in a second. In the French army, which in 1792 defeated the invading armies of Prussia and Austria at Genappe and at Valmy. The reason he was a general at the fairly early age of 17 is because his father, the Duc d'Orléans, was the one member of the French royal family who had taken the side of the revolution, changed his name from his many titles to Philippe Égalité, and indeed in January 1793 voted for the death of his cousin the king. And so his son got a sort of, how can I put it, seriously accelerated promotion and joined the army as a general, which strikes me as really rather a pleasant thing to do. And it's because Louis Philippe never let anyone forget that he was a general in that French army which defeated, etc., that we see here this trophy you see with all kinds of weapons. By the time this was made, sometime in the 1830s, obviously, something like 50 years had passed, during which Louis Philippe had come no closer to an army me than to be at the head of a review stand. Nonetheless, he would let no one forget, and I find it quite amusing, that in his bedroom, even, he made sure there was a military trophy. Now, the other thing that Mrs. Goodhue, and I think, after all, since she left her estate to the library, she would not feel we were presuming it when I say our Mrs. Goodhue. At any rate, her parents, at the same time, bought the Sèvres porcelain service made by Louis Philippe's order for one of the French marshals. And it is, of course, as usual, displayed right there. And it's the service, the plates, but also that urn. And quite a number of plates, as you can see. Very typical of the Sèvres production of the 1840s, with a sort of, it doesn't need to be too exact about these things, a sort of medieval pattern. You see, there's a lozenge pattern with a flower right here, and this was considered to be a medieval pattern. This may strike you as odd, but there it is. But it's not just a medieval pattern. You also have this pattern right here, which is a sort of grandson of the kind of neoclassical pattern you would have seen 40 years earlier. And then, in the center of the plate, there are various dramatic episodes of earlier periods, in this case, a sort of proto-Renaissance scene, quite high in color. I mean, they really are quite handsome plates in their way, or in this particular case, as you can see, a very dramatic Roman scene. And this kind of proto-historical illustration is entirely characteristic of what was being done at that period in France. Well, on their trips to Europe, and specifically to Italy, the Parkers bought sculpture. Well, then their daughter grew up and married Mr. Goodhue, and she and her husband went to Italy, and they bought more sculpture, which is in fact scattered amongst other places on the staircase right here. And this is where we run into 19th century sculpture, perhaps not quite of the same artistic quality as the portraits we've been seeing until now. Very often it's white marble, in this case it always is, in the Goodhue Collection, and very often it has a, I'm bound to say, slightly depressing quality. It is so carefully conventional, it is so obviously moral, that it makes you want to look somewhere else. And this is visible to a degree on this young woman. But then there is the other side of Victorian sculpture, which is, after all, you do want people to buy it. How do you get people to buy it? Well, probably it is the husband who is going to do the buying if it's a large piece of sculpture. If the husband is going to buy it, how do you make sure that he will buy it? Well, you think up a really proper and moral subject, and then you make sure that the young woman, who is the emblem of this moral subject, wears as little clothing as is convenient if it's going to go to somebody's drawing room. And so you see this surprised young woman who has lost her slipper. You can see her slipper is right there. Is wearing what I must say I think is a pretty deep décolleté. And in a century when women's skirts came firmly to the ground, and where not only in England but in the US the word leg was considered to be highly improper, you will notice that she shows a good deal of a really quite decorative leg. But the most perfect example of this is this young woman. Now, if you look carefully at her tiara, you can see that there's a cross on it. This is faith. Now, you tell me at the end of this lecture, if you can think of it, why faith should be severely undraped, showing a bosom, which furthermore looks very much as if plastic surgery had been invented earlier than we might think. having a naked-breasted fig, I must say, strikes me as a masterpiece of Victorian hypocrisy, and a very amusing one. Nor do I regret that it's part of the collection, because once again, what this collection does is to show us at different periods what people thought was okay, what they wanted, what they thought would look well in their house and make them look good. And I dare say that all the young friends of the Goodhues gave Faith a good deal of thought. Now, Mrs. Goodhue herself, when she bought, as I mentioned, encouraged, no doubt, by her parents' example, tried to buy pieces she thought were royal. And it is the case of the portrait that you see here. A wonderful frame, really spectacular, early 17th century frame. But the reason she bought it, and that you cannot see, but I will tell you, right here, there's the original label, which says it is a portrait of the Carcondé, the king's cousin who won so many military victories in the 1640s, 50s, 60s, and 70s, one of the great French generals. Well, we know what he looked like, the Carcondé, very characteristic. For one thing, he had a completely unmistakable nose. It was very large and it was very oddly shaped. And, I mean, you would not know the Concorde when you came around the door. This is absolutely not the Concorde. Furthermore, the costume, which this young man is wearing, dates to about 1690, by which point the Concorde was well and truly dead. So then the question arises, is it his son or his grandson? Well, no, we know what they looked like as well, and it's not. And so I'm afraid Mrs. Goodhue bought this in the hopeful but mistaken assumption that she was getting a French royal portrait. She wasn't. On the other hand, she did get this perfectly wonderful frame, which certainly these days is worth vastly more than the portrait itself. Here you see the face a little bit more, and it is not a very big and a rather distinguished nose, very different from the Condé nose. And then there was, what I'm about to say, is Mrs. Goodhue's greatest mistake. She bought, and the case is still around, right there, she bought something which calls itself the Déjeuner of Louis XV, made in Sèvres. The Déjeuner being, you know, the cup, the teapot, and so on, so the coffee pot, so on. Well, no, it's not. That case was made in the 19th century, and so was the porcelain. It is Sèvres, but it's Sèvres of the 19th century, not the 18th. It was made probably about 100 years after Louis XV's death, and I won't even comment on the sort of sentimental obnoxiousness of these two young women, but I will tell you that the quality of the gold, for instance, is really not good at all, and certainly nothing like what you would see in the 18th century. And then what is really a hoot, I think, is this supposed portrait of Louis XV, which doesn't look like Louis XV. So perhaps Mrs. Goodhue didn't have a very good eye for the resemblance of faces. At any rate, what she bought was unquestionably not what she had thought she was buying. On the other hand, when she bought this painting by Bouguereau, she unquestionably got what she thought she was getting. Bouguereau, today justly despised, was hugely fashionable in his time. His paintings sold for a very great deal of money, the more sentimental the better. This is really very sentimental indeed, this sort of doll-like young woman. But at any rate, she did, Mrs. Goodhue, what most rich, not all certainly, but many rich Americans going to Paris at this time did. They bought the then hugely fashionable French academic paintings. And I'm much too cautious to tell you what I think the equivalent would be today. But at any rate, when she paid no doubt a huge amount of money for the Bouguereau, she knew what she was doing, Mrs. Goodhue, and it's probably just as well that she's not around today to hear what we say about her choice acquisition. So I think we need to pay a tribute to her, because she left her collection and a large sum of money to the library, thanks to which we are in this wonderful building. So really, that's pretty good. We owe a tribute to her and to her husband's family because, willy-nilly, they have told us a great deal about taste and life in the US for just about a century. And it really is pretty interesting, I need to see it. And after all, she was, as her young friend said, the very pattern of a grande dame. And so I thought it was not inappropriate to end this talk with, well, it's a very handsome fan indeed, and you can see how it would add considerably to the majesty of her appearance. And finally, of course, with that pluck of recognizing the gift to the library, because in the end, it's because of her we're all here tonight. Thank you. And if you have any questions, I will certainly try to answer them.
Were any of the porcelain portraits falsely attributed ones ever identified?
The portraits were not who they're supposed to be identified. No, the portraits of the supposed Grand Condé, I looked at it carefully, and it really, I'm reasonably familiar with the portraits of this period in France. And I have to say, it was no one that I could recognize. I mean, perfectly prosperous young man, of whom there were very many, obviously. But certainly not a member of the royal family. Those portraits are all, you know, faces we know. The portrait of Saint-Simon, not, etc. So I really don't know who it was. The portrait that doesn't look like Louis XV is simply the work of a very, very poor painter on porcelain, but not, you know, anyone specific. What I didn't show you is that as part of the same set, which is over there, there's also a portrait of, a so-called portrait of Louis XV's wife, Marie-Lexascar, and it doesn't look anything like her either. But this is very characteristic of a lot of illustrated books of the 19th century, in which you have these completely imaginary portraits, because historical accuracy was still a very new notion. Certainly until around 1900 in France, history was considered to be, how can I put it, reading history was closer to reading a good novel than it was to reading a series of reasonably scientifically established facts. Footnotes are not a very old phenomenon, and so it didn't worry anyone if it didn't look like the real thing. The trick, and there were Americans of that period who were doing exactly what you were saying, going to France, or even not going to France, but buying very good things anyway, and they were those who decided to trust the eyes of really good dealers, Devine notably, but a number of others. And those collectors who said, okay, I want some, and many others. I mean, for instance, if you go to look at the 18th century French Met porcelain and the porcelain at the Metropolitan Museum, you'll see there's quite a lot of very good French 18th century porcelain, Sèvres, and that's because the collectors between 1880 and really the Second World War, I guess, were clever enough to know they didn't know, but clever enough to know who would know and who would get for them what they wanted. And clearly Mrs. Goodhue was perhaps too imperious to allow somebody else to make her choices and then just write a check, which for those who did has turned out remarkably well. For instance, Frick, of course, is another example. And she chose herself, but by not making very good choices, as I mentioned, she does tell us something about the period.
I'm not sure about the Parker's money. I know they had it, but
but I'm not sure where it came from. They clearly, whereas the Goodhues appeared to, as I understand it, remain close to their money and how it was being made, the Parkers, they always remind me of some of the characters in Edith Wharton's novel. They just have it. But I don't know how they did it. It's a very interesting question, and I think it's quite possible whether the Parker who was at the Met is a descendant of these Parkers, perhaps collaterally, because Mrs. Goodhue inherited her parents' estate. So there wasn't a brother who could have continued the line directly. But I don't know, honestly, whether they were Parker cousins. I mean, for all I know, Mrs. Goodhue's father had a brother who started the line which ended up in that Parker. Also, Parker is not that uncommon a name, but we can always hope.
I've been a member here for 40 years, and you really brought this just dead, all my whole membership here. And you've really brought it alive, or at least aliver.
One last thing. I don't think the library will be pleased if you bring a ladder and start climbing to see the place up on top.